nice pavilion and for having our side event today. And welcome to those who are online. So I am Paul Lu. I am the executive secretary of the 4 per mille initiative, and I will come to that initiative a little bit later to explain to you what it is. We are together here for 1 hour to demonstrate what agricultural soil can play as a crucial role in food security, but also in climate change fighting. The main question is how? How can we use soil and soil health to fight climate change and improve food security? Our speaker will help us, and of course, we will focus on America example in this context. So first of all, let me present to you our speakers. So we will have Mrs. Beata Madari from Embrapa, and she's a scientist from Brazil, and she will give us the opinion of a scientist and a researcher on these aspects. We will have also Mr. Oliver Gardiner. He is from Regeneration International, an NGO working with the 4 per mille initiative for a while, and he will give us a concrete example of what civil society can do in the field. We will have a video from Eugenia Saini from Fontagro, a funding entity in South America, and she will provide us her point of view about how we can use soil for that purpose in the context of a funder. And finally, we will have the pleasure to have Habat Chabi from INRAE in France that will give us the key messages that we can get from this side event to bring back home. So let me first start to explain a little bit what is the 4 per mille initiative, and then you will be able to see the global context. So is it useful after 1 week with having Ratan Lal on board to explain exactly what are the soil and what are the functions of the soil? But well, this slide just refresh our memory about all the function of the soil. And most of the people consider the soil as an inert part of our life where we step on it, we can sweep on it, but well, that's the origin of all life and we need living soils. So keep in mind the multifunctionality of the soils. Next, please. It's important to keep soil alive, and to do so, we need to store carbon, to have carbon in those soil. So it also helps us for three main functions. The first one is to mitigate climate change. So if you store carbon in the soil through the photosynthesis of the plant, then you will be able to remove this carbon from the atmosphere and help fighting climate change. Of course, we use what I call a low-cost negative emission technology using solar energy. Well, everybody knows that it's photosynthesis. It's not a new technology. It's maybe the oldest technology in the world. But this one is efficient and it's very powerful. The second point is that if you increase the quantity of carbon in the soil, you will help the soil to have a better capacity to keep water inside and also to resist to erosion. Erosion from the wind, erosion from the water. And this helped the farmers who use the soil to be more resilient and to be able to adapt to the ongoing climate change. Last but not least, we all know that when we increase carbon content of the soil, you increase the fertility of the soil. So you will, by chance, increase also the yield. But not only increasing the yield, you will stabilize the yields, which is also almost important, more important than even increasing the yield for the farmers. And of course, you will restore degraded land, which is very important. In some parts of the world, like here, it's very, very important. Next, please. So if you see all the role of the soil, carbon-rich soil can help to fight climate change. Organic matter in soil bring life and biodiversity in the soil and above the soil. Soil rich in organic matter can absorb quantity of water and be less sensitive to erosion to help combat desertification, and fertile soil improve food security. So if you look at that, you can check that healthy soil is the minimum basis to reach the objective of the following UN convention and organization. That means UNFCCC, UNCCD, UNCBD, and of course, the goal of the FAO. So just consider that the soil health is the indispensable starting point of all action. Next, please. So we know there is no miracle. We need to have some practice to help storing carbon in the soil. Well, there are some examples of what you can do. You can, of course, have conservation agriculture, integrated soil fertility management, water management, cover crops, organic fertilization, biochar, range management, agroforestry. They are all systems and practices that help storing carbon in the soil. But it depends on the location, it depends on the quality and the type of the soil, it depends on the climate, it depends on the biomass availability, and then you will be able to reach various percentage of quantity of carbon you can store. Next, please. This is coming from Ratan Lal. When you start using agriculture in a soil coming from forest, for instance, the quantity of carbon in the soil starts decreasing. And if you are lucky, you will be able to reach a new balance, a new equilibrium in the soil. But if you are not lucky, then you can reach the red zone, and the red zone conducted to the erosion and the disparition of the soil. But what we would like to have is to have an adoption of better management practices that would help going in the pink zone, so going up in quantity of carbon, and even in the green zone, in order to reach the saturation, the initial saturation. And maybe we can dream in the future, we can have some technology who can help us to go over this saturation. Next, please. So, yes, stop. You break my effect. So, when you ask a question in Pepin Street, civil society, the people will tell you, well, agriculture is good, produce food, but we would like agriculture to use less fertilizer from mineral, less agrochemical. And also at the same time, we would like agriculture to improve the quality of the soil, improve the soil organic carbon, improve the biodiversity. So they would like the agriculture to be along this red curve and along this green curve at the same time. But the conventional agriculture leads us here. Next one. In fact, we should get inspiration in the natural system, in the nature. I don't say we need to come back to natural forest and go hunting and fishing. And no, I'm not talking about that. I'm talking about getting inspiration in the nature, what we call nature-based solution. And if you get inspiration in the more complex ecosystem on Earth, next, then moving from here to there, you can call that agroecology. And please, you can finish the slide. The good news is that we already have agriculture that are doing, one more, that are doing all of that. They already exist. We don't need to reinvent them. What we need is to help farmers to find where they want to be on that sketch. People will stop here. Some people will stop here. Some other one here. Some are there. But they are already, or they want to move. We need to help them. This is just a future trend toward agroecology. That's what we propose in the 4PERMIT initiative. Next one, please. So what is about the initiative? I talked to you about the problem, how we can try to solve the problem, and what is the initiative? Well, where is coming this funny name, look like a low-fat yogurt? It's just coming from a back of the envelope calculation. You know, I think it was in France. It was after a dinner and was people drink a little bit more. Okay, so they just, it's a scientific calculation anyway. Don't let me know that I said that it was just a stupid things. Well, scientists compare the quantity of carbon already existing in the soil and the quantity in the atmosphere. Well, in the soil, altogether, we consider that there is between 1,500 to 2,400 gigaton of carbon already present in the soil of the planet. But if you look at the first 30, 40 centimeter, you will have between 860 to 1,000 gigaton. The human activity on Earth, those figures come from 2014, release in the atmosphere a little bit around 10 gigatons of carbon every year. And by chance, natural vegetation and the ocean recapture a little bit more than half. So the The net fluxes in the atmosphere every year is roughly about 4 to 5 gigaton of carbon. And if you compare this 4 to 5 to this 860 to 1000, then you answer the question, by which rate should I increase the quantity of carbon in the soil if I want every year theoretically to offset the quantity we release? And this calculation lead to 0.4%, which is 4 per 1000. And that's where the name of the initiative comes. So the idea is how just an objective, an inspirational objective, we need to improve the quantity of carbon in the soil every year, everywhere, to try to offset the maximum of the emission that we have. Next one, please. So the goal of the initiative is to increase carbon sequestration in soil, to increase food security, to help agriculture to adapt to climate change and to mitigate climate change. All of that, of course, in the world context of the SDGs. Next, please. So here is our members. Well, just the country, but not, this is only a small amount of all our members. Next, please. We started with 160 partners all over the world, and now we have more than 750 partners, 750, sorry. So 2 years ago, we adopt a very important document, which is a strategic plan. We give us our vision. The vision is a worldwide healthy and carbon-rich soils to combat climate change and hunger. And this plan, next, is organized in 6 main goals. And those 6 main goals are divided in objective. We have 24 objectives, and now we have adopted last year an implementation plan with a cycle, the mechanism that will help us to implement that in the field. And it will come with 148 activities. So of course, the initiative will not do all. We need our partners and members to do their part of the job. And we hope that people in America also mainly will be able to, we have a lot of partners there, but to do the job in their countries and in their regions. I think that's all for me. Next one, yes, no. If you want to learn a little bit more about our vision, this you know, the drawing with the various agriculture, you can get this book. It's in French, English, and Spanish, and the name of the book speaks by itself. Farmers have the earth in their hands. I mean, the solution is in agriculture. The solution is with the farmers, and that's why we need to help them going on the right way. More on our website, of course, and our collaborative platform. So do not hesitate to go there. And I will be happy to answer your question at the end. So now that you know a little bit more about the 4 per mil initiative, I would like to give the floor to our other speakers. And I will start with you, Beata. Beata, how research in Latin America and Caribbean countries could contribute to improve soil health and consequently to having a better climate and a better living for the people?
Okay, thank you, Paul. And thank you for being present. Well, thinking about how research could contribute to healthy soils and a better climate and living, actually a lot of things come into mind. But now I would like to emphasize one of the things where it can contribute, and it's, and the research and sciences contribution is very important, which is the development of public policies. Next one, please. Okay. Okay, thank you. So Latin America, South America, and actually in Brazil, there is a huge diversity of agricultural systems. So they are different in scale, the technology, the level of technology that is used, in resources, in the intensity of the production. And also in Brazil, at least, we are working in 5 different, very different ecosystems. And the next one, please. There are about 223 million hectares in Brazil that are under agricultural production. This is about 25% of all land area of Brazil. So imagine if we, so part of it is degraded, like we have a total 151 million hectares of pastures, and about 70% of this is in some kind of state of degradation. And also 63 million hectares under crop production, and most of it are annual crops. So imagine if we take all this land that is already under agricultural production and we improve improve those that are still under non-sustainable systems. We implement practices and technologies that make these systems more sustainable. So, but for that, we have to have a broad way of thinking. So these systems have to evolve to economically, socially, and environmentally sustainable production systems. What I mean on this? Well, if we, when we improve, when we try to improve the sustainability of production, we usually also increase the complexity of the production. So farmers, they will have to have new knowledge, more complex knowledge. They usually will have to invest, and part of this investment, including has to include infrastructure as well. And they also have to have different approach to market, and they have to know a more diverse market. For example, integrated crop livestock forestry. Farmers who were working with crop production only, and they implement integrated system, they will have a very diverse products to deal with and find a market for. It can be wood, the products of the part of the animal production, and also, for example, the annual crop part. So there, it's about there where public policies come into view, and they are very important to give guidance for farmers how to do that, and more very important incentives to do that, and support to do that, and do all this so that farmers are they'll be thinking in doing it in long term, and to maintain the sustainable production systems in long term. The next one, please. Okay, so the example that I can bring is the policy for adaptation to climate change and for low carbon emission agriculture of Brazil. So actually we are in the second phase of this, and it was created already with the experience that we had in the first one, which ended in 2020. And of course, all this policy framework, it was created based on the scientific knowledge, which many of it EMBRAPA brought, but also with the collaboration of the academics, universities, organizations, and including international organizations' experiences. So there are, this policy is based on three pillars. It has an integrated landscape management approach, which gives us the possibility to also harmonize it with the forest code, which regulates the use and preservation of natural vegetation. Also, the second pillar is based on working with adaptation and mitigation at the same time. Both adaptation and mitigation is very important, and they are interlinked on all levels of production. But for example, for smallholder or subsistence farmers, adaptation is very, very important. They have less impact on the mitigation of greenhouse gas less impact on the emission of greenhouse gases. On the other hand, which is Brazilian very common and occupy a huge land area, is the large industrial type production. So there we have to focus on reduction of greenhouse gas emissions, so on the mitigation part, but also keeping in mind that these corporations, companies, they also have to be able to adapt to changing climate. And the third pillar is encouraging. This is the part when the support comes in view. So we have to encourage the adoption and the maintenance of sustainable systems, well, systems or practices or the products. Okay. And okay, next slide. Okay, so I would like to mention the principal technologies. Actually, it is based on 8 technologies or practices that this policy recommends. Well, all of them has a calculated mitigation potential, but 3 of the 8 actually also has a substantial potential for carbon sequestration in soils. Okay, so these are the restoration and recovery of degraded pastures, and the promise is 30 million hectares more compared to the first phase. Also integrated crop livestock and forestry and agroforestry, and the zero tillage system. I always think it is important to mention for us, zero tillage system, and we emphasize the system because it's not only direct planting. It's also obligatory includes the inclusion of the rotation cover crops and also green manure. So that's the no-tillage system. The next one, please. And so for the record, I also mentioned the other technologies. Here it is much more for these technologies. They also can have benefit for soil health and soil carbon sequestration, but it's much more difficult to define the exact contribution. So plantation forests can play a big role in mitigation and adaptation as well. The use of bioinputs, which along with the many many technologies that already exist all over the world, that has the most impact is the biological nitrogen fixation. And irrigation, it's a new technology in the, and also bio inputs, bioproducts is also a new technology in the second phase of the policy. And I have put it there in small letters, 2 other ones, the management of waste of animal production, and also the intensive terminating of animals in the creation, but I put it in small letters because these don't have direct impact on the soil, and the soil management is not included in the practice. Next one, please. So research already had its challenge and science to in the creation and the development of the policy. But we still have important challenges because we have to make these sustainable production systems or practices available and more effective by working in ways so that it can be adapted regionally. So we have to provide solutions that work for different regions. Because as I mentioned, if you think only in Brazil, it's a very diverse mixture of very diverse ecosystems. Also, we have to specify for production systems how these technologies could work, because the policy has a general recommendation, but we still work on how it will work for specific production systems. One example is, for example, cotton production. It's very difficult. It's usually made in zero tillage, but it is very difficult to include in this production system the rotation with cover crops, for example. And why? Because it might contaminate the product during the harvest. So actually, right now we are working on possible solutions, because the way it is produced currently, it's not sustainable at all. So to work with smallholder producers, we will need very strong public extension services to reach this scale of production. Working with large producers, companies, corporations, one way that we think very useful and is starting to work very well are private-public partnerships, and we do a kind of co-innovation. So these companies, they came with their ideas, they implement experiments, and we are helping them to choose the right solution, and also recommending what to experiment with. It's a little bit slower process, but it is important, the experimentation part, because they will see that yes, it actually works, and bit by bit they can actually introduce it in their areas, and the impact of this for mitigation, it can be very high. So there are farms that are working on 50,000 hectares. So imagine the impact if they can adapt sustainable ways of production. Another important challenge for research still, and I will be very specific here for soils. So monitoring, reporting and verification for soil carbon sequestration. So quantify the change of soil carbon stocks. And try to include benefits for farmers with this. It is still a challenge. I think we all know that. And also a little bit more specific part, we have to work with indicators, and especially indicators for soil carbon permanence in the soil, guys. But on the adaptation part, we also need to characterize the levels of sustainability. So here we also need useful indicators so that we can indicate interventions and adjustments that can enhance sustainability and the adaptation capacity of systems. And there is still risk management in agriculture. I will not talk more a lot about it, but like agriculture, for example, there are many things that we can do. But for example, agricultural zoning is important, and now it is even more important that it is periodically revised, exactly because of climate change. So it's actually the zoning is changing. The adaptability of the plants is changing a lot. And finally, what I would like to emphasize is, well, it is very important in every level of production that we concentrate on the basis of the basic natural resource to regenerate the soils. So we have to find a way. Usually we talk about regenerative agriculture for smallholder production. But I think it is also very important for the large scale, where it can have the impact on mitigation on large areas. And with this, we don't only improve soil quality or soil health, but also the whole environment of the production, which is the real basis of sustainable agricultural production. So today, almost every large corporation has its governance. But actually, what would make a great difference and for the acceptance of these corporations as well, if they put a lot of emphasis on the quality of the basis of the production, so the soil. And they are starting to understand this and starting to invest in this kind of research and the adoption. Thank you very much.
Thank you, Beata. I mean, you go more research and relation with private sector and policy, which is very interesting. So, Oliver, you come from Europe, not really
Hi.
an
Yeah.
American country, but you represent Regeneration International, an international NGO. You will speak in behalf of Ercilia Suarez, who will not be able to be with us today from Mexico. And Oliver, how could civil society, through some example, could contribute to get healthy soil and improve the climate and, of course, the living of the people, with the focus of Latin America?
Well, the way we're contributing is we're facilitating knowledge exchange. Yeah, we're facilitating knowledge exchange, and one concrete example that we really are promoting at the moment is a silver pasture, is an agave-based silver pasture agroforestry system that we have implemented in central Mexico with our sister organization Via Orgánica. And so, but you know, who better than the farmers to actually present the project? This year I worked with the farmers to gather some video messages to actually demonstrate what they're doing in the field. So I'll just in if you could just please launch the UNCCD SMA testimonial video, and we'll go into more detail after watching this video. Thank you.
Que no requieren fertilizantes o riego, sino la planta y hay un tipo de entrega de
trabajo. El millón de dólares genera economía para campesinos y campesinas.
Hola, ¿qué tal? Os saludo desde el proyecto de Dios Ángela de Guatemala. Es una estrategia que pretende cambiar de alguna manera cómo se ve el paisaje que viene a uno de la mar. Una estrategia que pretende volver los ojos a Madrid nuevamente y es una planta aliada de la vida. Es una planta que captura CO2 del ambiente, que además es refugio de flora y fauna silvestre y que retiene los suelos. Planta que asociada con el término se vuelve una planta que resiste los climas generales, que se adapta, que se vuelve productiva. Beneficios como alimento, como material para la construcción, como fogato para los animales.
El beneficio de la gente es que la porque no es una invitación a que todos pongamos muebles de marca de muchos de 20 kilos, con 20 kilos, que deja de estudiar a los 20 días, se les da el de agua, tenga precios y gallinos cerdos.
So there you go. That's what our friends from the Ejidos, which are small hold farming communities, there are around San Miguel de Allende, which is a beautiful city, UNESCO, a UNESCO area in central Mexico, just a 3-hour drive north of Mexico City. So this is what they have to say about these systems. Now, what we also understand about these systems is that agave has been dubbed recently by an Indian scientist as the bamboo of the dry land, because they can be found practically in almost every dry land on every continent. And just one example is in Myanmar, where we started a pilot project there because they're growing as an invasive species. And so to kind of regulate that invasiveness, we started to set up a project that really supports dry land herders. supporting them, especially in seasons where forage is low. And so this is something that can be done elsewhere, notably in the Mediterranean region, in Europe. We saw this summer forage going really low. We practically ran out of milk in France. So these are systems that we're promoting. But as you know, agroforestry really is about the farmer knowing about what trees she or he has on his land and how he can use the trees that are there to boost agricultural productivity. So it's not just about agave. You don't want to start planting agave everywhere. But we know that there are many regions around the world where they do grow. And when combined with nitrogen-fixing trees, it boosts the growth of the plant. And so if you can plant them preferably with biodiversity lanes and nitrogen-fixing trees, you really are doing carbon sinking, because actually, as you saw the figures there, so we have universities in Mexico that work on this, that do a lot of research on this. The main scientist that works on this is Dr. Juan Fritas. You can look him up. He will have all the data, and he'll be better. He'll be able to present the research better than me. But those are our sources. So it sequesters huge amounts of carbon. And so those of you who are interested in carbon markets, agave comes under the clean development mechanism. So you're able to develop. Very low cost. So 1 kilo of feed. So as you saw here, we're making feed. So it comes out. So we need to chop it up. Animals will not graze on agave just like that. You really need to chop it up. You need to ferment it. And once it's fermented, it's very nutritious. It comes out as a probiotic. It's a bit like kimchi or coleslaw. But you need to mix it. We won't give them 100%. We'll chop up some mesquite. We know that it's growing in areas across the great, in the 11 countries of the Great Green Wall. We've seen agave grow there. Different species, species that were imported by colonialists because they were the colonies, because they used them a while ago to produce textiles. But today, but over time, these agaves have sort of naturalized in these ecosystems. But we're seeing they could be combined with, like in Africa, you have a wonderful tree called the Phytophthora albida, which is a nitrogen fixing tree which is a bit of a weirdo, because it will grow its leaves during the hot season and shed its leaves during the wet season. And that could be combined. That could be, so you could grow corn under it. You could grow pulses, you know, a range of crops. And because these trees shelter animals, you could have an agave system there as well, wherever they're growing. So that's that. And thank you very much. So just San Miguel de Allende. So Regeneration International, Via Orgánica, and also the municipality of San Miguel Allende are partners of the 4 per 1,000 initiative. So we've signed on. And that's it. What can I say else? There's a bunch of other stuff, but we could go all day. Yeah. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Oliver. Thank you. It's a good example of what we can do in the field, and in particular in some area which is very arid. So now we have a video from Gina Saini. She is the technical secretary of Fontagro, and I would like to hear from her what is the perspective from a funding agency such as Fontagro in the context of what we were talking about, soil health. So if you can please show the video.
Thank you very much for inviting Fontagro to this panel on sustainable agriculture on the American Canadian, organized by the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation in Agriculture and Health. Thank you to my colleagues for getting the panel. My name is Aurelia Peroni. I am the head of the MNU of Congress. I will introduce you to this presentation, sharing my screen. We were invited to talk about Fondarro's contribution to healthy soil in the Latin American monetary system. We are a sustainable co-financing mechanism for the development of agricultural technology and innovation for the gas solution. As I said, I am the president of Fondarro, and I want to share with you a brief presentation about who we are and what we do and how we solve it. Ontario is constituted of 15 countries, 14 in Latin America and Spain. These countries decided in the late 90s to create a fund, a sovereign capital, which through the years can create value in two different ways. On one side, the return on a portfolio investment, and second, the return on research and development investment. The initial capital was $80 million. And today, after 34 years, our portfolio is valued at $100 million. But at the same time, we have a co-invest in all the agencies and the local council parts, and $137 million. Our legal representative is the Inter-American Development Bank, and together with the Inter-American Institute for Cooperation and Culture, we help to design and implement more than 185 international projects in the region. Our board is constituted of the president and national directors of the Agricultural National Research and Innovation Organization of the 15 member countries. We as an organization and as a region share common challenges that require a solution when it comes to research and development for the agricultural sector. We face these challenges related to the increasing agricultural productivity, but also innovation and security. We still face that challenge, but together with so many others, as the impact of the climate change, as the need for more sustainable and resilient agricultural production, and also to change, the price inflation of both inputs and commodities, and the management of natural resources, and among those soil, water, biodiversity, which are crucial, and more recently, the pandemic and the war. How regions and countries can cope with so many complexities and create opportunities for a better solution. When looking at soil, and from especially the power statistics that show that for agricultural land is about 4.7 million hectares, which is one third of the global land area. Agricultural land composition is one house, the house of crop land and two thirds of the middle of pastures. In the 90s, crop land has increased by 5%, and on pastures is increased by 6%. Asia, the Americas, and Europe accounted for 80% of the crop land. Forest land is about 4.1 million hectares. And as a population grows, the world crop land area per capita also increases. Fondarro, as a regional and international cooperation mechanism, has invested together with other agencies around $58 million in the last 24 years. Topics that were directly or indirectly related with the soil. Fondarro directly contributed with 23% of the agency 12% and the local council part 65%. The main topics of research has been adaptation and mitigation to climate change, how to decrease emissions from agricultural activities, related to agriculture, soil biology, and dynamics. Different production systems from banana plantations to livestock and crops, how to identify advanced practices for sustainable intensification and carbon sequestration to decarbonize agriculture, how to use new technologies and remote sensing to with new data that generate information that helps design more sustainable relationships. How to support handle society, farmers, and other private and public stakeholders that together can bring their room to help soil management and for the community. Fontano currently has a portfolio of international projects for uses, finance, and innovation that includes more of the vertical and transversal policies. Our new term and then try to highlight the farms that probably will farm and then sustainability and resilience to focus on the ecosystem, the value chain, and the territory. Strategic 3 focuses on agriculture and food industries, water communication, and health. Since we work with the International Network of Scientists, we have selected our work, and we are here to present, for example, in Poder, but also to create an digital platform. We are always trying to support their work and help in any way we can among many folks. Following some about our presence in the region and Spain and how we perceive natural representation, private representation, and many other stakeholders in the region. I'm going to introduce some initiatives very briefly. For example, one of the projects that we are currently we have an execution is the sustainable investigation of prison based legal systems. This is a hub of 8 countries, including Argentina, Chile, the Dominican Republic, Ecuador, Nicaragua, Paraguay, Uruguay, and Brazil. These are initiatives co-founded by Gonzalo and the Global Digital Alliance of the Primary Industries of the new government of Brazil. The goal of these initiatives is to use strategies to sustainable, intensify, and support the action while adapting and mitigating the climate change through the group-based budget management. Another very important initiative is the carbon sequestration opportunity for oil in Latin America and the Caribbean. This project is a hub of 5 countries, including Argentina, Chile, Colombia, Uruguay, and Costa Rica. It is an initiative co-funded by Fontano and also the Global Research Alliance from the Ministry of Primary Industries of the Government of Argentina. The goal of this initiative is to lead a strategy to sustainably identify agricultural production by adapting and mitigating the climate change by identifying opportunities for carbon sequestration. This initiative is also part of the City Farm project led by Dr. Nathan Land from Ohio State University. There are many other initiatives that Fontano has contributed in the last 2 decades to follow research. Some organizations that joined the innovation have are public, private, local, national, regional, and international. We reached out to 580 organizations in 735 countries. We want to share some final ideas about the collaboration across borders. Agriculture has been and will continue to be fundamental to our economies in Latin America and the region, and its competitiveness depends on its capacity for innovation. Innovation capacity is promoted through the creation of a multi and interdisciplinary network. Soil health is crucial to maintain a healthy agricultural sector, and the social value of soil needs to be recognized. This is from an important research from Dr. Radan Lal, which we are really very thankful to work with him. Thank you very much.
Thank you. I like the final idea. Abad, I hope that you capture that one. Thank you. So before we opening for the floor for one or two questions, We'll have 10 minutes, no more, and to also conclude, I would like to emphasize the fact that from 23 to 25th November, there will be in Mexico an international meeting for America on soil, water, and biodiversity. We in partnership with the IICA, FAO, and all members of the 4 per million initiative. So I hope that you will also attend this online if or live if you can go there. So is there any question from the floor to our panelists? I mean, the one who are here. Yes, please.
Yeah, thank you very much, Shani San Martin from ICA. I wanted to congratulate you, first of all, for the 4 per 1,000. What I was thinking along that line is how, what is the perspective or the action as it relates to the messaging for not only the quantity of carbon, but the quality of carbon, particularly in respect to what the researcher was saying here in terms of carbon permanency. For example, in the tropical soils mainly, the potential of sequestration is a good indicator here, but the actual practices that are needed to actually get that permanency of carbon there, it's a whole different issue here. And the practical issue, particularly in conventional system. So I just wanted to get the perspective, the rate of degradation in tropical soil is far beyond most of the temperate soils. What is the initiative or what has the researchers been doing to actually do that, particularly in the context of conventional agriculture, which I think we also have to focus on as we transit to the other thing. What can we do there to improve the sequestration there? Thanks.
Beata, you want to answer?
Well, it's not that easy to respond that because that's actually one of the main problems. But well, we focus on, for example, on the quality of the organic matter that is the organic matter input in the soil. So and then we can well, for example, for carbon sequestration, we have some examples from long-term experiments that we all know that, for example, we need nitrogen input to sequester carbon. But if this nitrogen input is not coming from a biological source, then sequestration and also the quality of the organic matter is different. So actually, in some experiments, we see that when the nitrogen source is biological, then we accumulate more carbon and different carbon in deeper soil layers as well. So I think that what is very important is if we pay attention for the quality of the entering carbon in the soil, the permanence we have to of course see this we have methods to examine this, but this surely will affect the permanence of carbon in the soil as well.
Thank you, Beata.
Thank you very much. Wonderful presentation. Welcome to all of you to the Home of Sustainable Agriculture of the Americas. We're delighted to have you here. Rotten Law would be proud of your presentation. What I liked about your presentation most is the simplicity of the communication, and that's something that we all need to have so that we can communicate the importance of soils to farmers, to policymakers, to constituents, to our neighbors here who should understand how farming helps the environment. Loved the agave presentation. I think we should all go to Mexico to enjoy agave there. Thank you.
Yeah, we have a wonderful farm there that's waiting for you. Our farmers are waiting. They will welcome you. We have a wonderful restaurant, an organic store in the city. We have an eco lodge and a beautiful hotel. I mean, you really will not regret visiting us. Yeah.
Well, San Miguel's beautiful. We'll have our representative to Mexico be there in a couple of weeks, hopefully. I wanted to ask you a question, Beata. Your presentation was excellent, and you talked about working with the private sector in order to get more data. One of the things we're working on with Dr. Lal is called the Living Soils of the Americas, and where we're working with companies like Bayer, Syngenta, Pepsi, in order to do samples in test plots and to examine and measure data and find best practices. I want to know, what can we do at ICA, working with Embrapa, working with One for 1000? How can we all work together in order to get more companies involved in that, measuring soil data?
Well, I get the difficult questions. Well, I think we are getting there, that these companies, they are aware that they have to, they themselves have to contribute to the work. So what to do, what extra we can do? One thing is to involve, but do not stay only national. These are international problems, and the attention of the world, attention and the involvement of international organizations, I think it's very important. And we have to, there is one question that, okay, we are collecting data, you are collecting data, but the availability of this data it would also be very important to be able to have results results in a more efficient way. So maybe ICA, for example, which has quite a great influence in the international community, could also mediate about the importance of this and help us finding ways how we can work with international data, how these companies could let us use their data in a way that it is safe for them, but then at the same time we can get the scientific knowledge out of all this. Data is very important, it's very expensive to get, so we have to have a good use of it.
Maybe I can complete a little bit. I show you that the 4 per mille, we have a strategy 2050 with a lot of objectives. Some of the objectives can be picked up by large company, and they can accompany the alliance of the actor, various actor, multi-stakeholders that could help addressing those objectives. So we can continue this exchange if you wish, and we can see how we can improve that, because we need to have business on board. Definitely we will not do it without them, but they need also to be convinced by the way the farmers are working. And this is very important, and we need research for that. I'm sorry, we are running out of time. And I would like our friend Habat Chabi to give us the key message to bring back home after this side event. So Habat, the floor is yours. And bring us some light and some good ideas to bring back home.
Yeah, it is a very difficult task, Paul, for the...
I know, that's this, why I ask you.
To do this kind of summary in a short time, but also to bring you to the key issues. So anyway, Paul started with a very good introduction highlighting the importance of soil and soil not only in terms of climate change mitigation, but also ensuring food security. And one word that's very important, I don't need to repeat here, is the also peace. Don't forget degraded soil also is involved wars, involved hunger, but also immigration. Just in 2018, to give you one number, 86.5 million immigrant refugees to the degraded war, but also pushed by the world war. That means a degraded soil need to be restored, and this is one of the key issues, and need to be restored in order to transform this degraded soil to a healthy soil. So the healthy salt circuit can produce food, that can produce many services, as is highlighted in the slide here. But also soil health also is a promising lens through which to approach land management. That means having the potential to serve as a descriptor of biophysical processes, which is if we need to have a healthy soil, that means that you have a kind of function, but also as an effective communication tool across what you, Beate, said, to across stakeholders and so on. One important thing that is slightly highlighted here is about the how to quantify the healthy soil. It is a difficulty in terms of what means that healthy soil, and linking the healthy soil to assessment outcomes. For example, different multiple problems still persist in an obstacle to quantify what is in a healthy soil. That's specific measurement that are needed to quantify that. But anyway, if we move to the research back a little bit far away from what's been said in terms of the definition and all of these things, but one important thing, so one key message that I would like to stress here, the importance of research to improve soil health. For example, we have the soil degradation and how to transform the soil degraded soil into an economically, socially, and environmentally sustainable production system, which is helped by Beate. That involves also complexity. We need also the knowledge toward measurement and monitoring. This is very important. Without this, we need to have at what extent the management that we are putting in this system is also increasing the soil health, including soil carbon storage and so on. So we need this measurement and monitoring. But very important to keep in mind, without investment, what I mean investment, public investment, but also private sector, which is very important. We have to work hand to hand on improving this finance funding. And important things also that is always keep away. And then we come all the time as a scientist, but also as a manager, without involving the farmer. Farmer as a key players, they know what they are doing. So they should be part of the game. Without them, we cannot do anything. And of course, coming as the best example, what you show is that take what the advantage from what is already in system. Don't try to change the system radically to move, put something, but it is very important to have what they are there and then to help them consider and improving their subsistence. So healthy soil and salt is a very good example as a showcase in Latin America. Thanks, for example, to the multiple Fontagro that's gathered, if I understood, 15 countries with a huge amount of money to address some common challenges and shared solution to feed the 10 million people, but also to help increase in carbon storage and carbon sequestration as an opportunity, but as a goal in these Latin America countries and Caribbean. And the final idea is that really what is expected, the importance of agriculture, not for feeding people, but also as an economy, as a subsistence of this innovation capacity in terms of tool, not only on technology, but also best management that's adapted to the region specific areas. And of course, soil health. Without soil health, we can do nothing. So this is what I have captured during this time. And I hope that I cover all of your key messages, and if it is something still missing, I would be very happy to.
I think it's very complete. You had even more than you also put some of yours message, but you're right. It was very important. Yes, thank you very much. Thank you very much to all the panelists. Thank you very much to the attendants here and the attendants online. And if you want to get some more about the 4 per million initiative and all those very nice partners that we have, please go on our website, www.4p1000.org. Thank you very much.
Thank you too.
Yes. Thank you, my dear.
Very well done. Thank you very much.
Thank you.
Of course. We'll take a picture together.